Interesting story here developing that if I've in general, that kind of illustrates the really annoying part of sports or football or just culture in general when it comes to the UK. There is this idea in general where I've got what was it? There was some finding or some report recently that got done where they basically were able to say that there's no such thing as institutional racism in the UK and all this sort of nonsense, right? Which is by the by, I'm not really someone that plays a race card too tough, but what I don't like is just a failure to recognize or to kind of admit what reality is staring you in the face with, right? And we tend to do that a lot in the UK. There tends to be like, unless something is like, unless something can be illustrated in black and white terms, people just don't want to admit it. And even if they are illustrated in black and white terms, they still make excuses for it. And this Harry Kane Tottenham training fiasco thing is a great example of it, right? For the most part, you know, most people should be aware of Harry Kane is England captain, star striker for England, and obviously captain for Tottenham. Somebody that's very in demand, high quality striker, scores a lot of goals, contributes a lot to the team, and generally regarded as one of the best strikers in Europe, if not the world, right? He's now failed to turn up to training twice now. I think Monday and Tuesday, he didn't turn up for training for his team Tottenham. And the reaction from the press and from the media has been demonstrably different to how the same treatment was given to somebody like a Paul Pogba when he was kind of flirting with the idea of leaving United. He's kind of stated on many times that he wants to leave and seek new, you know, adventures, which is more in his, which is definitely in his right to do so as a sports, as an athlete, as a sportsman, whatever. You only got a short career in football. You need to go explore all your options. Fair enough. But he didn't go as far as not turning up for training. He didn't go as far as like not playing for the team and not being available for selection. He just basically admitted and kind of, you know, put the feelers out there that he wanted to leave. And then obviously his agent, Mino Raiola, is the one that basically annoyed everybody in the club, right, in terms of how he goes about things. But Harry Kane, if we're not mistaken, has done this, spoken out quite, you know, vividly about his desire to leave Tottenham. Also did that really weird walk and chat with Gary Neville where he basically was trying to plead to Daniel Levy's conscience in terms of allowing him to leave. And then now he's deciding to go on strike effectively and not turn to training. Now, the weird thing is, the weird twist is that supposedly, from what I've read between the lines, Harry Kane and his team are telling Tottenham that he's not turning him to training because he's isolating at home because he's on holiday at the Caribbean with his family, which obviously is nonsense. He's just doing this to kind of force Tottenham's hand. And of course, if you know anything about Tottenham and how they run with Daniel Levy, you'd know that Daniel Levy is one person that would never be bullied, supposedly, according to a lot of the things I've read online as well. I think it might have been from Fabrizio Romano. I forgot who it was from. The Here You Go guy. He said something along the lines of like, Daniel Levy is the most difficult person to deal with in English football, hands down. Of all the people to deal with in, no, I think English football, maybe Europe, I don't know which one it was. Maybe English football. Let's look at English football. The most difficult to deal with. And if you know anything of the history of, you know, star players for Tottenham, whether it was Luka Modric or Gareth Bale or Dimitar Berbatov, when players have decided to go on strike or do anything like this, he's kind of gone out of his way to be even more vindictive and kind of stall the delays of the transfers. Obviously, eventually, all those players left, but he's gone out of his way to make it very difficult for them to leave. And I think he's said from the very onset, said that he didn't want to sell Harry Kane in the first place, and it would take a stupid offer for him to get out of the club. And I think, didn't they try to, I think Man City or someone tried to offer like 100 mil or something within that kind of remit, and he basically turned it down and said nah, not a chance. So he'd rather kind of let the player run out his contract than obviously let him go. And like I said, it's really annoying because the difference in the response from the press has been so stark if you compared it to how Paul Pogba was treated. And if, again, just kind of just thinking theoretically here, if Raheem Sterling did the same thing as what Harry Kane is doing now, just imagine what the presses will be saying, or the media, especially places, papers like The Sun and stuff, if he ended up doing it, or Daily Mail. It'd just be absolute pandemonium. So this title says the following: Harry Kane, Tottenham striker, fails to show up to preseason training again amid Man City transfer request. Or sorry, transfer interest. Harry Kane is supposed to show up at Tottenham training ground for the second day in a row. The 20-year-old was due to return to Hotspur on Monday following a short holiday. Speculations around his future gathers pace. But Kane did not report for preseason training and was also absent on Tuesday morning, 2 days in a row. It's understood Tottenham are disappointed with Kane's actions and are set to fine him, but are aware the England captain is planning to return this weekend. So he's told them he's going on a strike for a week, but he's going to return on the weekend, which obviously is a benefit only given to the best players of the club, right? He's best player. He's the most important player. If anybody else, right, if this is Serge Aurier, they'll probably tell you to stay where you are and they'll terminate your contract. But you know, they give him the kind of grace in order to do so. And then it continued to discuss exclusively reported on May that Kane had told Spurs he wanted to lead the summer, but Man City, Manchester United and Chelsea supposedly interested. At the end of June, Man City made a 100 million bid for last season's Premier League Golden Boot winner. Kane is valued of upward of 120 million and Tottenham are keen to keep him despite the striker believing he has a gentleman's agreement with Daniel Levy. And therein lies the issue, right? Twofold. Number one, Man City offered 100 million for him last season and Tottenham obviously turned it down. The reason being, for the most part, is that if you're not familiar in football, scoring goals is one of the hardest things to do, and finding goal scorers who can score those goals for a various amounts of teams regardless of what systems they play is also very, very hard. And for whatever reason, nowadays seems to be one of the most hardest times to find quality strikers. There's a real drought in real top level strikers. There's obviously Harry Kane, Haaland, some people would refer to Mbappe. There's not a lot of strikers who are operating on that high level that a lot of the big teams would kind of pin their hopes on, and this being the guy, you know, Robert Lewandowski, of course, at Bayern Munich, but a lot of people then stay still. You know, he's got a bit of a flat track bully record in terms of how he's basically been able to perform in the Bundesliga vis-a-vis when he plays for in Europe, or sometimes when he plays for his home country in Poland. But regardless, strikers are one of the most, you know, rare commodities out there in football. So with that being said, it makes complete sense why Tottenham would turn down such a bid, because, you know, they could basically put any price on him and he's still worth it, whether it's 300 million, 200 million, whatever it may be, because of the goal return. If you're at the top level, then you'd assume, if you're Man City, that he's going to hopefully fire you to league. He's going to hopefully fire you to Champions League, and the money that you generate from those campaigns would pay back whatever fee that you basically paid for him. But unfortunately for Harry Kane too, he's just over. He's just kind of at his peak now. He's at that age. What is he? Probably 28. Right, he's not going to get any better than what he is now. If anything, he's going to start declining ever so slightly. He's obviously lucky that he doesn't really, you know, rely on his pace too much. He's kind of an intelligent player who can drop deep, hold the ball, pick it up, whatever. He can finish in the box, he can finish outside the box. So he's a kind of quintessential striker who relies mostly on his technical ability, his space, his awareness, his footballing IQ. So he may be able to prolong his career, but in terms of his ability to kind of hold up the ball, you know, play it into other midfielders, that's going to diminish as the years progress, and it's only going to get worse as time goes on. And obviously the other thing to kind of note as well, which has been reported I think, what is it, in 2021 in May earlier, Harry Kane signed a 6-year deal recently, right? A 6-year deal. I think it was in 2018, if I'm not mistaken. And for whatever reason, who knows why he signed that? Most probably because of the money, right? The money was probably too good to turn down. But he signed a 6-year deal. Where is it here? This is from the Independent. Oh, I can't see what he signed. Yeah, there we go. The Premier League. So Kane was passionate about the club when we grew up, promising academy goal scorer. And when he signed a long-term deal in 2018, Spurs were near the peak of his powers under Mauricio Pochettino. So he's basically kind of got only himself to blame, because so far he's been coached under Pochettino and Mourinho. Pochettino being the only kind of manager who kind of got them close to even trying to win any sort of trophy. And obviously Mourinho was a bit of a disaster. But in order to, you know, no player in their right mind would sign, you know, for Tottenham for 6 years under Pochettino, if you had any sense about you, you would obviously sign maximum 3-year, or maybe a 2-year deal, maybe 4-year deal, but not 6, because it puts him in a really bad bargaining position when it comes to kind of trying to get out of the club. And this whole gentleman's agreement thing is a really bad move in terms of Harry Kane dealing with someone like Daniel Levy. He should have never ever let it get to a point where they had a verbal gentleman's agreement they shook on. It should have been something that was put in paper in black and white when they signed his contract in 2018, that here's my price that I want to kind of agree with the club with. If a big club outside, you know, in the top four, sorry, comes in for me and they make this bid, automatically it triggers my ability to kind of negotiate with them directly. That should have been done in black and white. That's what top players do. But I think at that time, you know, he probably was a bit nostalgic about the idea of finishing his career at Tottenham. He thought Pochettino was going to stay forever and ever. Things were looking up, you know, whatever it may be. But in terms of thinking long term, and maybe that's just a fallacy of a football player, they're not necessarily the most smartest people in the world. But sometimes, you know, the bigger the player are, especially the high profile they are, the more of like a brand they treat it as. So they have people around them who can kind of spec out a long term vision of how they want their career to go and end it effectively. But this is maybe a consequence of supposedly Harry Kane's got his brother as his agent. This is probably a consequence of it. When you've got your brother dealing with your business dealings and you're probably both as smart as each other, which isn't that smart, this is where you kind of get hoodwinked in the position where you accept a really high, you know, a really kind of lucrative new contract 6-year deal, which I'm sure put his earning potential or his weekly earnings probably up in the high 200,000s, maybe even 400,000s at Tottenham, which is a really high wage for that level of a club, which is obviously a good bump from what he was on previously. But then when it comes to trying to win trophies and get to the point where he wants to be remembered as like a legend and all-time great in the Premier League, he's in a position where he's basically been held hostage at Tottenham until his contract runs down and Spurs are in no position to sell him because they know they could never rebuy anybody of that level of quality again, right? It makes complete sense why they're basically going to be strong in his position. Levy, who was appointed Juventus former football officer, Fabio Paratici as the club's new managing director, said in June he sympathises with Kane's frustrations about the lack of silverware, but hinted that the deal could be difficult to do. Which makes sense because we're in a COVID market. Unfortunately, in a COVID market, because clubs have had the inability to generate any gates and any kind of revenue on match day, which accounts for a big number of, you know, a larger number of their kind of revenue share, it means that a lot of clubs are kind of scrimping and saving and basically not willing to shell out the big bucks in order to sign players because, you know, they just don't have the money to do so. They're not projecting to make a lot of money in the maybe a near to distant future, and they want to be able to just, you know, survive with what they have, which is why a lot of the bigger teams haven't really made any really, really big transfers as of yet. So with that being said, and the lack of players moving either way, he's in a position now where only a few clubs can afford him, and the ones that can afford him don't need him at this current moment right now, except for obviously a Man City, but the others can wait. Man City chairman Khaldun Al-Bumarik meanwhile said after last season Champions League final, the club can be competitive and aggressive in the summer and is aiming to strengthen by bringing quality to the squad in the key couple outcomes position. And then obviously we've got here a quick update courtesy of The Athletic pinpointing the developments. Harry Kane has no plans to return to the Tottenham Hotspur, supposedly, according to him. So this idea or this suggestion he's going to return on the weekend, it looks like it's not true. The club won't sell him to a Premier League team, which they're adamant about. Levy insists no gentleman agreement is there, which is I'm of course sure on. I'm a big believer that both things can be true. Maybe they had a gentleman's agreement, but to Daniel Levy, unless it's on paper, it doesn't really matter. And of course, like I said, he's been referred to widely as somebody who's very difficult to deal with at the best of times. So in this position, with, you know, dwindling revenue streams coming into Tottenham and their inability to buy anybody in the first place, they have to sell to buy anyway, he's definitely not going to be willing to sell him at any given price, especially if it's not a crazy one. The anger side in preseason last year, Man City think they will sign him, Tottenham will find Harry Kane. So what a crazy time to be alive. But still, man, it's just a shocking state of affairs. It again goes to show that there is definitely a difference in how black players or foreign players are treated in the English press. And again, I wouldn't have an issue with it if they just were straight up about it, honest. I understand why they would maybe treat Harry Kane differently than how they would treat a Raheem Sterling or a flipping anybody that isn't an England captain. It makes complete sense. But let's just be honest about the portrayal of how certain players are portrayed or how certain players are kind of reported on in the media, and just admit at the end of the day, all players do this, right? All players want to, you know, are basically glory hunters, right? They want to achieve more, they want individual honors, they want to win club trophies, all this stuff, right? They want that, especially players at the top level, because your career is short. You don't want to waste your career, especially if you're somebody that's highly regarded as one of the world's best, playing for a team that has no ability of winning any sort of trophies. What's the fun in that, especially nowadays where you're able to kind of create a legacy or a memory based on one trophy, because we've got, you know, social media and the ability to record and capture all these live events. You can chop it up and clip it up and make it into much bigger of a deal than what it actually is. Why not? You know, if Harry Kane just winning one Premier League title is enough to kind of solidify his status as one of the Premier League greats forever and ever, just one he needs, you know what I mean? And he's still got plenty of time to win that one. So I definitely understand his need to do it, but let's not chastise other players who do the same thing just because of the different, you know, they have a different color of skin or they're from another country, because effectively all football players do it. Clubs are not loyal to players. Players are not loyal to clubs. It is what it is. The only thing that's loyal to any of these clubs is the fans at the end of the day. And let's just grow up about this whole issue in general. That's what I think.